is Mind Your Own Business with Mike and Matt, Race Car Radio's podcast for business owners, entrepreneurs, and aspiring entrepreneurs. I'm David Hoffman, and your voices of reason are Mike Ganzel and Matt Plosiak. On today's episode, how do I know I can afford to take on more staff? Featuring our special guest, Harrison Wise, the founder of Wise Public Relations, a boutique communications agency focused on solving real business challenges for global organizations at the intersection of technology, innovation, creativity, and commerce. So today we have Harrison Wise, the proprietor of Wise Public Relations, and he has a question also about taking on new staff, but maybe from a different angle. Harrison, what's the issue you're having right now?
Thanks for having me on today. So my question is, you know, how do I know when and if I can afford headcount, new employees?
That's a good question, Harrison. As you know, we've been working the last few weeks in determining that, and you've gotten some new clients, which is why you're anxious about hiring some people so you can actually deliver to the new clients. Exactly. And keep your current ones.
Let's get a baseline here for the audience. How big is your operation right now? How many employees do you currently have?
So six employees, and we have about 10 accounts that we service of varying sizes, but...
And how many do you think you might need to take? Like, what's the growth that's in?
That is part of the question. I definitely know that I need two people at the account kind of management level. Yeah, that's kind of the immediate need.
But you're thinking maybe, so if you're hiring two, maybe hire three or?
Yeah, something like that, right? Yeah. You know, depending on what their salary is, you know, it's always going to be that range. But, you know, salaries are inching upwards. So, you know, you get less for more, which isn't the ratio I'm looking for, but it's the reality.
Cool. Go ahead, Matt. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
No problem. And just if it's germane, he has an office in San Francisco, and we'll have one in LA shortly.
That's correct.
Interesting. So three offices each with two people in them is kind of where
San Francisco has three, New York two, and one in LA.
And what do those people do? The six that you have, are they all just sort of account people?
So I'm included in that number, but so I obviously run the agency and provide strategic counsel to our accounts and leadership and mentorship to the team. One of the executives in San Francisco runs our West Coast operations, but he also works on accounts across our West Coast client base, and he manages two junior staff members. And then LA is a content marketing specialist and an event marketing specialist, but who also has a PR background, and she's joining us literally like as we speak.
So Harrison came to us and said, I need to hire people, but I don't know if I can afford to. So we sat down with Harrison and we did a cash flow projection for 2 months out, looking at the clients he has, his current expense, and the added expenses he expects by adding two to three people. And fortunately, we found that, yes, in fact, he can afford to hire certainly two and possibly three and still end up with a positive cash flow. That's assuming he doesn't lose any current clients.
So Matt, is it as simple as that?
Well, it is if you're generating enough revenue and your expenses are low enough to afford it.
But is that okay?
Now, the biggest problem, though, Michael, as you know, we go to a client and we say, oh, so how much what's your revenue going to be this month? Gee, I don't know. Well, how much are you going to collect this next week? I'm not sure.
But see, that's the pain point is collecting, right? Cash flow, yes. is the part that trips, you know, me up is, you know, I know the revenue's there and, you know, so I know like we have the business, right? But it's all dependent on when are right. people paying their retainer so that way I could pay my employees.
Correct. There are three or four buckets, right? The money can come from one, from revenue from your clients for the current month. Two, accounts receivable, money that clients owe you from prior work that was done. Three, cash already in the bank. And four, most businesses have some type of line of credit.
And five, Harrison's pocket.
Your own pocket. Yeah. We try to avoid.
Yes, let's scratch that one, please.
we're not talking about that. Fortunately, Harrison doesn't need to do that, although some of our clients find that time to time they have to do that.
Matt, let me ask you a money question.
Sure.
About sort of calculating that, because I think, what is the real cost of hiring an employee? I think a lot of people aren't hip to that in terms of, I mean, if you're paying somebody $40,000 a year,
besides their
how much
salary,
does that actually cost? How much money do I actually need to have to do that?
You need between 15 and 20% more on top of that. So you've got to multiply that 40,000 by about 1.2.
Really? I'd say higher, because benefits these days.
Somewhat depends what benefits you're giving them.
So,
I mean, if you're just talking strictly Social Security, Medicare taxes that you must pay, it's about a little less than 10%. You know, it's about 8-point-something%. So, but depends what kind of benefit. If you're giving health care, if you have a 401k, et cetera, you know, easily 20% is a good rule of thumb. Could be as much as 25%.
Yeah, I'm using 25% these days. I think 20 is a little low.
And, I mean, do you also need to figure in that person's going to need a desk and a computer and a phone?
Well, that's,
and
yes, but that's those are one-time charges and not a monthly ongoing. But that certainly is an expense as well.
So I guess I was lucky in that regard. I had the foresight when I started to lease the office that we're in now in New York. I built out space for growth. So we have room for five more headcount. So there's five desks in our office.
So here's a question I have for you. It's almost a chicken and egg kind of thing. Why wouldn't you have hired people first, then find the business, rather than find the business and then hire the people?
That's exactly what I wrote on my piece of paper, and I even wrote chicken and egg.
Uh-huh.
I just want to point that out. Okay.
That's a great question. I don't know if I have the answer to that. You know, in theory, you don't know if a client that you're pitching is going to come on board. So to hire in anticipation of potential business is a very risky endeavor.
But you've done that.
I have done that, you know, just, you know, you kind of feel optimistic and, you know, you things are kind of looking, you know, on the up and up, and, you know, you do it.
There's a weird dance there, isn't there, with clients that they want to see capability before they want to hire you. And so you have to show them, we have the team ready to go. But
very valid.
Then you're paying people to sit around until you do. How do you
totally
swing that dance?
Well, I can't say that I have swung that dance, you know, but that's a very valid point though. We, especially in our industry, clients do want to see and meet the team in advance. You know, we have to use the team that we have. That's really, you know, that's what they're getting essentially, you know, at the start. And you know, we just put our best foot forward.
I have a question. Something, you know, being someone who owns a creative company, and I think what you do is creative in a different way. But it's a question that's going to apply. Something that's always scared me about growth is maintaining quality. How do you make sure, as you're growing, as you're bringing on new people, as you're not perhaps touching every client yourself, that the work that's being done is still something that you're proud of and, you know, is up to your standards?
Well, I think we're still of a size where I can have a pretty clear oversight of whether or not we're meeting client expectations or not. But certainly it's something that, you know, I think with these new hires, I'm hoping to address. I'm looking for people who, you know, put client service first, who understand project management, how to really make sure that we're delivering against the plan that we've set out to meet our clients' expectations. So hiring for that. So, you know, really finding people who know how to ensure that we're you know, kind of you know, setting the bar and staying at that level.
But actually, this is a good point to talk to you, for you, Harrison, about what is the business culture that you want? And we've talked about that a lot. So, you know, I know you are driven now to grow the company, but I also know that all your working, you are driven for certain goals and a certain culture. And so tell us, tell the world, tell the people who are listening to this podcast, what is the culture that you want in this growth?
That's a good question. To be honest, the culture question still trips me up. I'm not sure we have a culture. I think the team that we assemble, the team that I have, defines the culture as it is now, but you know, we're adding in new people that I think will shift and redefine what our culture is. I certainly, you know, intend to kind of set the tone of the culture, but I also don't think we have a clear definition of what our culture is. We certainly have, you know, our vision and values, but in terms of culture, I think the team really kind of instills that into the organization.
Well, I don't know if I agree with you.
Okay.
Mind
your own business.
I'm trying to. I don't want to just mind my own business. I want to mind your business. That's my job, is to mind your business. But look, if you have vision and you have values, you have a culture. You have a culture. And so the reality is directly, you're going to hire somebody who doesn't promote your vision? You're going to hire somebody who doesn't promote your values? No way. So then, for all intent and purposes, you have a culture, and you set that. When you say you set the tone, you're setting the culture. You have a culture. Your culture is service-oriented, customer-focused, you know, work hard, play hard, you know, all those things. I know those are general things, but in reality, the people you're hiring are some reflection of your personality.
The original question here was, how can you know whether your finances can accommodate taking on new staff? So, Matt, give us a summary. Sure. What are really the steps there?
So, it's really knowing what your revenue is, as well as cash flow coming in, and the cash you need to spend going out on a weekly basis, and then add those 1, 2, 3 salaries to your cash flow spreadsheet and see, are you going to have enough money to pay these new people?
In essence, what Matt is describing is literally a KPI, a key performance indicator. And unfortunately, we find too many small businesses that we work with or that we know out there, they just don't do that. But that's your KPI. And that requires that weekly attention. Just does. And I think you would be the first to say that this is the point. So if you're going to grow your company, you better have that KPI put together.
For sure. And I and Matt, maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong, but also incorporate factoring in the pipeline, I think, is probably not as relevant as obviously cash flow and revenue, it let you act tangible revenue and cash flow. But the higher probability of prospects, I think, also would at least afford you the confidence to hire an extra person.
For sure. That definitely gives you a little more visibility further out, right, which is very helpful.
Harrison, while you mind your own business, I'd like you to let Matt and I help you mind your own business.
Anytime, guys. Anytime.
We'll be right back with more from Mike and Matt about how to grow your company wisely after these brief messages. If you're enjoying this show, you might also like some of the other podcasts on Race Car Radio. For instance, try London's New York. Your guide, Dan London, takes you on a deep and opinionated tour through some parts of New York City that are a little to the side of the usual tourist trail. And along the way, teaches you something about the extraordinary, rich, and diverse history of one of the greatest cities in the world. I guarantee you that it's a view of New York City that you've never had before. Listen and subscribe now to London's New York at racecarradio.com. Race Car Radio is proud to support the work of IO Worldwide, a tenacious and dedicated organization working to address the root causes of poverty in West Africa, because they believe that who a person is and where they come from should not solely determine what they are able to achieve. To learn about their work and how you can support it, please visit ayaworldwide.org. And now back to Mind Your Own Business with Mike and Matt. So I think the larger question here is about growth and about the right way to grow. And I'd love to talk a little bit more about that dance we talked about, that chicken and the egg dance, about do you build capability to impress your future clients so that you can get more clients, or do you go out and try and build clients so you can afford to build capability? How do you score? Because it's a catch 22, because clients want to see capability, but you can't afford to build capability unless you have clients.
Well, it's a real dance and balance, and sometimes you're forced. Like early in our Netlink career, we had a manufacturer that came in and said, "Where are your engineers?" And we said, "What do you mean?" They said, "You need engineers to be one of our partners. So we didn't have a choice. We had to go out and hire a couple of people, and then we had to make sure we had enough business for them.
So I remember that. So I took a little note, and I'd say this. You have to have a certain amount of money to invest, and you have to be willing to roll the dice for a period of time. So if you said, I need $100,000, I have that $100,000, I'm going to take that $100,000 and I'm going to invest in more people. I don't have the business yet, but I'm going to use that $100,000 to hire people, and then they're going to go out and get me the business. And then you say to yourself, well, how long can I do that? Can I do that 3 months, 6 months, what that is? So you have a pool of money and you use it. And so you do the capabilities first and then find the business. The other way is you do the business first and then you scramble to develop the capabilities. You're a good salesperson, you do great marketing, etc. You basically find the business because you didn't have that pool of money. So instead of money, you're putting in sweat, and you're basically going out there, finding the business, and then scrambling, or not necessarily scrambling, but then finding the capabilities. Single answer. The other thing really is sort of, I think it really does really come down to, do you have the money to invest and do that? So just, you know, Matt and I had an investor in our company. We took that investment, we put it into the company. And we spent $250,000 on marketing, on building a training center. We put that money into the business. And in essence, we built our capabilities before we had that business. That worked. But there were times when we first started where we didn't have the capabilities, so we had the business. So maybe the answer is, on some levels, is it depends on what point you are in your development of a company that you do that. Jobs, for instance, you know, when Jobs did the iPhone, he didn't go out and do research for the iPhone. He basically said, the market needs this. He determined it, and he does the iPhone. So really, so when you're thinking about your own business, what do? You think the business is out there, so I'll invest in people, and it's there, I'll just grab it? Or do you say, let me go out and check if the business is out there, let me get the business, and then I'll bring the people?
Well, let me ask a very base level question. And I imagine this is the kind of thing you come out of business school knowing.
Or the School of Hard Knocks.
Well, right, which I'm enrolled in at the moment. You know, people talk about getting seed money, getting investment to grow your company. How exactly does that work?
Well, typically, it starts with family and friends. That's, well, besides the owner's own money. So an owner has to be investing his own money. And usually after the owner's money, usually it's family and friends that believe in the owner, want to help the owner out, and maybe, hopefully, they hope they're going to make some money.
Basic level and beyond that, like when you take in an investment, right?
Yes.
How does that contract look? How does that transaction work? Well, how does that person get paid back?
Well, let's say apart from family and friends, the only reason an investor is investing money in a business so he can get a return. So to go to the higher level, a VC is looking for 10 times his money or more, because he has a lot of dogs he has to account for along the way of the big home runs. But generally, an investor is, you know, wants to be able to make some multiple of sticking his money in the bank and or in the stock market, because that's much more liquid. If you're investing in a private company, you need the investor was going to want to have some idea, how am I going to get my money back? Are you going to pay me interest? Am I going to give you, is it a loan? Am I giving you money for stock? I mean, Michael and I have had experience, you know, owning a small piece of a private company is nearly worthless unless there's some kind of exit strategy.
Really, there are four elements, just to be repetitive of what Matt said. You have to have a plan. And that plan basically has to say, you know, what is your strategy for growth? What percentage of the market in your sphere are you going to capture over what period of time? And how are you going to do it? And then the question is, you know, what is the return that you're going to give an investor? Now, an investor will give you two types, will give you money in two, actually there are two types, debt or equity. So debt is a loan. And so, and by the way, banks don't fall into this category because banks don't give you money to grow your company. That so you'd be going to a private equity fund, private investors, a public, whatever it would be, which invest money. And they would basically look for, so then there are two ways, debt, which means it's a loan, you have to pay me back X percent on my money every month, every quarter, etc. There you go. Or it's equity. I want X percent of your company. And at some point when there is an exit strategy where we sell the company, I will get X percent of the sale price. That's how it works.
With the first one of those, what's a typical return someone's looking for on a debt investment? Are they looking for 15%, 20%?
Well, it's some risk versus reward. Mm. So if I got, let's say that you had somebody was considering investing in your company and they were getting 6% for their money, nice safe vehicles that they were getting 6%. And then you came to them and you had a plan and they realized that what your plan was risky, but certainly interesting, they might want 12 to 15%. They might want 20% on their money. So, you know, that would be, they want whatever they want. And you'd have to either say, yeah, they're a candidate to loan you money to, you know, invest or not. So it really comes down to what you'd negotiate. But it's got to be a multiple of what they would get in a safer investment. Otherwise, people don't do it.
Sure. I know that makes perfect sense.
And the key also that I believe is that people who have intellectual property are more likely to get investors than people who, let's say, are just doing a service. Because, you know, service can go away, and intellectual property like software or some type of hardware or something that is actually tangible, you know, has a different value than just a service, in my opinion.
Mike, Matt, thank you guys as always. And, you know, until next time, why don't you mind your own business?
Michael and Dave, I think you should mind your own business.
Well, all right. Coming from you, Matt, the best I can tell you is, mind your own business.
Thanks for listening to Mind Your Own Business with Mike and Matt. Tune into upcoming episodes for conversations about the power of abundant thinking and much more. Never miss an episode by subscribing to the show on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Stitcher, and many of your other favorite podcasting apps. You can find those links at www.racecarradio.com/mindyourownbusiness. You can also follow us on social media at MYOB Podcast on Facebook and Twitter. Our guest today was Harrison Wise of Wise Public Relations, www.wisepublicrelations.com. The stars of the show are Mike Ganzel and Matt Plosiak of Voice of Reason Consulting, www.voiceofreasonconsulting.com. I'm David Hoffman, and I produced and recorded the show. It was edited by Austin Cologne. Mind Your Own Business with Mike and Matt is a production of Race Car Radio, www.racecarradio.com. Race Car Radio is a division of Citizen Race Car. We tell stories.